Hi, my name is Stephanie, and today I want to talk to you about a sense we have called proprioception and its connection to autism. So proprioception, like interoception, is one of those very important senses that a lot of people don't really know about because it's not one of the five main senses. As stated in a book by Christopher Norris, proprioception is the awareness of the body in space. It is the use of joint position sense and a joint motion sense to respond to stresses placed upon the body by alteration of posture and movement. He continues by further explaining some of the main aspects of proprioception, or the ABC of proprioception. These are agility, balance, and coordination. Agility is the capacity to control the direction of the body or body part during rapid movements, while balance is the ability to maintain equilibrium by keeping the line of gravity of the body within the body's base of support. Coordination is the smoothness of an activity. This is produced by a combination of muscles acting together with appropriate intensity and timing. And generally, I've heard proprioception explained as your body's sense of where it is in space. For an easier understanding, Middleton Center for Autism explains it as the following. The proprioceptive system provides us with a sense of body awareness and detects/controls force and pressure. The proprioceptive system also has an important regulatory role in sensory processing, as proprioceptive input can assist in controlling responses to sensory stimuli. Now, you may remember a video I previously did on sensory seeking and avoiding, and how some sensory seekers do things like press too hard on stuff, or like to jump, or stomp, or maybe get rough in play with people, etc. A lot of those specific behaviors are seeking proprioceptive input. According to the Middleton Center for Autism, proprioceptive input can help with regulating emotions or behaviors, and also cause alertness for some to be able to focus and learn. And of course, those who are proprioceptive input avoidant wouldn't necessarily enjoy these types of things and might find things like pressure or whatnot to be overstimulating and would avoid them. So some of the actions that would indicate that someone is seeking proprioceptive input are listed as the following. Bite/chews on objects, example, sleeve of jumper, pen or pencil. Hyperextends joints, for example, bending back fingers, locking knee joints. Bangs body parts, for example, bangs hands together, bangs jaw with hand. Holds objects with excessive pressure, for example, pencil, writes heavily on page, enjoys rough and tumble play, but can be excessively rough with others, throws self heavily onto floor, prefers to run, jump, or stamp heavily when he or she should be walking, likes to sit with knees tucked under himself or herself, engages in weight-bearing activities, for example, swinging on desks, climbing, walks on tiptoes. Note that there are other possible factors for this gait pattern. Seeking proprioceptive input is just one factor. Those actions really describe a lot of typical autistic behavior. In fact, one of the most commonly known autistic stims, hand flapping, can actually improve proprioceptive awareness. When I read the whole thing about hitting your jaw with your hand for this, I was kind of dumbfounded, because this is a thing that I do, especially when I'm starting to get really stressed and am not regulated, and I wasn't sure really what the purpose of that specific thing was. Usually it's toward my face, but almost always lands on my jaw, and unfortunately sometimes too much. That's very interesting that that specifically would be seeking proprioceptive input. Now, additionally, autistic people are known to have issues with posture, balance, coordination, etc. Many studies have looked into this and found that proprioception has a lot to do with it. According to one paper, the autistic brain built a stronger than normal association between self-generated motor commands and proprioceptive feedback. Furthermore, the greater reliance on proprioception, the greater the child's impairments in social function and imitation. This suggests that the autistic brain puts a greater reliance on proprioception when it comes to motor movements and function, and that the more the autistic brain or that person put emphasis on proprioception, the more difficulty they had with things like social interaction and imitation, which may be in part because the whole imitating part has a lot to do with being able to be well coordinated with your motor function. Another study actually discusses more on proprioception and processing that and its effect on motor planning. This study's results suggest that children with ASD present with distinct patterns of proprioceptive processing difficulties on four items measured by the COP when compared with typically developing children and children with DD. These difficulties included difficulty with feedback-related motor planning skills, tiptoeing, pushing others or objects, and crashing, falling, and running. Our findings suggest that proprioceptive difficulties among children with ASD may contribute to decreased motor planning and postural control, and to disruptive behaviors that negatively affect their participation in daily tasks. So that disruptive behavior being described may be kind of talking about sensory-seeking activities and actions, stimming, that kind of thing. I think the idea here is that if autistic people were more regulated, they would have less of a need to do those things, and thus would have less disrupted participation in social things and other activities that they're supposed to be doing. Now, decreased motor planning is a significant issue and can really harm people who have trouble with communication. So these issues with proprioception and motor planning, etc., may be in part due to the fact that autistic people tend to over-rely on proprioception instead of on visual information. Researchers suggest that individuals with ASD form stronger than normal representation of internal models of action between self-generated motor commands and proprioception. They suggest that differences in cortical organization and integration of proprioceptive information may account for the difficulties with body awareness reported in the ASD literature. It may be that individuals with ASD rely more on proximal or near senses, such as proprioception, than distal or far senses, such as vision, to direct movements and actions. So, because autistic people tend to have motor issues, a lot of people begin to wonder, maybe these are actually just comorbidities with other motor disorders. Most often, motor disorders connected to or associated with developmental coordination disorder, or DCD, is typically kind of what people suspect. This is also called dyspraxia. So one study set out to see if this was the case, if autistic people just have comorbid dyspraxia, and this is what they found. Although there were similarities between the profiles of children with ASD and those with DCD, VSC-DCD or MX-DCD, these similarities were not associated with the predictive diagnostic markers that characterize subtypes of DCD. Instead, many variables, visuospatial, motor structuration, synkinetic movements, dynamic balance, manual dexterity, coordination, praxis, bodily spatial integration, and digital perception, differed among the three groups. The best performance was observed in the children with ASD. The neuropsychomotor profiles of children with ASD and those with VSC-DSD or MX-DSD differed. Impairments of ASD are specific about lateralization disturbances and support the hypothesis of proprioceptive impairment due to visual fixation problems influenced by muscular tone in relation to the subcortical and cortical structures and possible interhemispheric disorder. So for our purposes, the gist of all of that is that while there were similarities between DCD or dyspraxia and the subtypes and autism, the defining characteristics that would definitely be like, yeah, this is definitely looking like it's a dyspraxia or one of the subtypes of that, were not the same. So autism didn't have those, and autistic people tended to do better in the areas that they were testing, basically, versus those who did actually have different types of dyspraxia. So what's interesting about this is, one, we should note obviously that you can have autism and dyspraxia comorbid. However, if you're noticing that you do have motor issues, posture issues, etc., that doesn't necessarily mean you have a separate comorbid. That might literally just be autism. And then additionally, they go on to confirm the concept of the overreliance on proprioception, or the issues with understanding or interpreting proprioceptive input, all of that jazz to do with visual things and that kind of issue. I'm not gonna try to break down all the big words for you. That's kind of the general idea. feel free to look into that for yourself if you would like to. With such a reliance on proprioception being seen in autistic people, even when it isn't exactly considered to be interpreted properly or integrated properly, etc., we are seeing a heavy reliance in general on proprioception for autistic people. It's no wonder that a lot of the actions that are proprioceptive seeking behaviors are your typical autistic behaviors that people notice. Obviously, a lot of people will be doing this who need that input because we want to regulate our emotions, our system, etc. In addition to those who are just hyposensitive in general. If you're looking for some proprioceptive input activities, whether for you or for people that you know, children in your class, those sorts of things, the Middleton Center for Autism lists some ideas on their page. I'm going to read some of those, and then I encourage you to go ahead and look at my references in the description box and find this and go see kind of more details on more specifics or how you can come up with ideas for yourself. I think there's a lot of great information on there. Proprioceptive activities involve providing intensive input to the muscles and joints. Some ideas are provided here, but you may wish to develop your own ideas, which will suit your students and your classroom routine. Think of activities which will work the muscles and joints. Weight-bearing activities, for example, crawling or push-ups. Resistance activities, for example, pushing, pulling. Heavy lifting, for example, carrying books, cardiovascular activities, for example, running, jumping on a trampoline, oral activities, for example, chewing or blowing bubbles, and deep pressure, for example, tight hugs. So again, be sure to go ahead and check out their website. They have some more specific ideas and some ways to kind of integrate this into maybe classroom settings, etc., so that it's not like really awkward, but yet it allows someone to maybe covertly be able to attend to their sensory needs, and I think that's awesome. If you enjoyed watching this video, go ahead and give it a thumbs up. Let me know your thoughts in the comments below. Do you find yourself to be seeking proprioceptive inputs, and is it because you tend to be hyposensitive, meaning you need more input than normal people, it seems, to feel things in certain ways, or are you more like needing it to regulate, etc.? I'm interested in what your thoughts are. If you're interested in autism-related content from me, you can go ahead and hit that subscribe button. I upload every Thursday at 4 p.m. Central Standard Time, except for the last Thursday of the month where I try to go live with all of you. Thank you to everyone who supports me here on YouTube as YouTube channel members, those who give through Ko-fi, my patrons on Patreon, and a special thank you to my spaz tier patron, Philip Noah. Thank you so much for watching. I hope that you're having a wonderful week, and I'll see you in my next video.